entry. The people exult as Jesus rides in procession through their village to the gates of Jerusalem. A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 21, verses 7 through 9. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven."
Okay, we think we're seeing a parade, and we know what parades are all about. You plan them ahead, they come on special occasions. There's all the organizations that have to be invited to have a unit or a float. There's making sure that the parade's on a theme, that the theme is cohesive with what the holiday or the special occasion might be. We know what parades are all about. But parades are planned events. And this is different. The village elders did not sanction this procession. The police did not issue a permit. This gathering is coming from a different place altogether. The sight of Jesus riding a donkey and a colt, get your head around that for a second. The sight of Jesus riding a donkey and a colt is a vision that harkens back to ancient times. But I think it's fair to say that the common people of Israel and Judah had endured royalty for centuries. Certainly, there had always been a segment in society that had wanted a king. We must have a king. We're not happy unless we have a king. So Yahweh gave them a king and said, "You'll live to regret it." Royalty had separated them from their covenant connection with God. Starting from the time when the entire nation of Israel won a great victory, but it was David who made a spectacle of himself, dancing nearly naked in exuberant celebration and leaving no space for the people to join him. In Jesus, who came out of the countryside, who didn't ask to be part of a procession, but in Jesus, they could respond from their hearts with shouts of celebration, shouts of blessing. The song of the people, the song that we call the 100th Psalm, captures the response of that village to the sight of Jesus. In its energetic rhythms and unpredictable shifts of meter, we feel the Spirit's work swooping and dipping, diving through the crowds, uniting individuals into one united flock, evoking a deep, visceral acclamation from God's people.
Thank you.
resolve. Jesus looks upon the temple as God's home and resolves to claim it for the holy. A reading from the Gospel of Mark, of Matthew, chapter 21, verses 10 through 13. When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." Then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple, and he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. He said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you are making it a den of robbers."
Jesus arrives in the holy city of Jerusalem with Hosanna still ringing in his ears. The crowds in the narrow streets want to know who he is, which seems kind of remarkable because it was a festival week and there were lots of strangers in town, but very few of them were bringing in this kind of tumult. The response from the procession really is not terribly helpful. They say he's Jesus, a prophet. He comes from a small town you never heard of, up in the Lakes region where you go on vacation. The scene that greets him is an orderly display of organized religion. In order to enter God's house, the temple, Jesus had to go through the portico, the front porch. And there was a lively market taking place on the portico. It was not something that had happened at random or unauthorized vendors. It was set up to serve the pilgrims. But what looked like sacred holy service was in fact a kind of holy pantomime. It was a service that was rendered in consideration of the offerings brought by pilgrims to the temple. Now, pilgrims have come to Jerusalem every year as part of the Passover festival. It was impractical to carry live animals with them for the ritual sacrifice that was required of them, especially those who had traveled from far-off lands for their once-in-a-lifetime look at the temple. They had neither sacrificial animals with them nor any of the local currency. So, vendors were sanctioned by the authorities to set up in the portico of the temple to take care of their needs. A pilgrim could get their exotic currency converted into shekels. Certified sacrifice-ready animals and grains were available. And the vendors made a profit, and everyone was happy. Except that Jesus is not, because he doesn't see religion. He doesn't see faith. He sees an abomination taking place. And in his violent and emphatic response, Jesus names the problem. The worship of God had turned into a routine transaction. Instead of entering in prayer, pilgrims were made anxious about what they lacked. Instead of being blessed by their time in God's house, leaving with a sense of prosperity and well-being, they left poorer and perhaps just a bit disillusioned. The land of milk and honey had become the market of bilking money. People's desire for connection with God stood a good chance of dying in the hustle and greed of the marketplace. The house of routine and rote worship suffocates our connection with God, then and now. Allowing our practice to become routine is dangerous. Squeezing the unpredictable out of our encounters with God turns our faith into habit and our habit into mindlessness. It's a kind of death, a death of the spirit, that kind of death where we move zombie-like through the motions of faith is no match for the power of love. Love is strong as death, says the preacher in Ecclesiastes. Love is strong as death. Its flame cannot be quenched by the waters of routine. Its spirit cannot be drowned by the floods of habit.
Declaration and rededication. Jesus restores healing to the temple and answers his critics. A reading for the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 21, verses 14 through 17. The blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he cured them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the amazing things that he did and heard the children crying out in the temple, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they became angry and said to him, "Do you hear what these are saying?" Jesus said to them, "Yes, have you never read? Out of the mouths of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise for yourself." He left them, went out to the city of Bethany, and spent the night there.
When the temple is cleared, once again there is breathing room. And into that space pours the forgotten, hurting populace of Jerusalem. Blind, and lame are guided over the debris of the market stalls, brought close to the prophet who has now set himself up in the space where before there had just been commerce. With the cries of, "Get your sacrificial doves here!" with those cries no longer echoing in the sacred walls of the temple, there is space for the Spirit to work. Jesus cures them. Jesus offers healing. Children punctuate these moments with shouts of grace. Hosanna! Hosanna to the Son of David! The Spirit of God is found to be escaping our efforts to channel and tame it. Those acts of healing, those shouts of praise, provoke a response from the religious establishment. Now understand, the evidence of God's work is right in front of them. There are people who couldn't see who now have vision. There are people who couldn't walk who are now on their journey. There are people who were so ill that they could barely summon the will to live, who are embracing new life. The evidence of God's work is right in front of them. But they focus on the claim, entirely true by the way, that Jesus is a descendant of the revered King David. This hick from the sticks, this guy from the northern lakes, he's a son of David, he's a prophet, he's an heir to the royal line. They are angry. They try to persuade him to stop the madness, stop the shouting, shout, stop all that's going on around him. And Jesus answers that their quarrel isn't really with him. Their quarrel is with God's Spirit. God's Spirit who's working through the children's shouts. God's Spirit that's not affected by their anxieties and fears. And the momentous day ends with Jesus leaving the city for the night. Jesus' work could be understood as a sustained aria of praise, a lyric raising up the wonder of God's bubbling creative energy, a verse wondering at the continuing emergence of a universe exploding into being. But that praise is not just from Jesus. That praise is in every molecule and atom and particle that buzzes with God's unimaginable energy. The fabric of the universe itself is an ever-changing paean of praise. Our consciousness and actions are a sentient expression of that for praise, along with all beings that live and breathe, animals and plants, microbes and amoeba, giant whales and nanobes. With them, let us offer praise to God. Let us receive God's blessing. In the days ahead, may you be aware of the transforming spirit that works to make itself known. May your care for ritual and routine be enough to carry you into God's presence. And may that presence help your routines drop away in the praise-filled exaltation of your soul. May the promise of Jesus' message of new life become your reality. May you be blessed in the name of the one who created you, who redeemed you, and sustains you through the journey of this holy week. Amen.
Amen.